thanks for the kind and fun introduction. And as you can see, the talk title is a bit of a tongue-in-cheek one, and so are the pictures here. I don't actually work on these particular creatures here, but I like this picture because it sort of summarizes how my career started from, you know, looking at birds and mate choice and all this kind of like standard things, how we think reproduction is organized and the questions that arise from there. But as I've moved on, I've been more and more impressed by the amazing biological diversity that there is, that reproduction can be organized in so many different ways. So why is there some logic to it as to why it's often done in a particular way as opposed to all these other ways, such as, you know, why are there sometimes cases with this extreme dimorphism in body sizes and yet usually not? Well, dimorphism is not what I'm talking about today. This is just to sort of get you into the mood of thinking about these things. But given that I started this question about males, it's, you know, especially when there's mathematicians in the audience, it's good to define what you're actually talking about. And it's quite astonishing that when you give your undergrad lectures about males and females, then often people don't actually know what a male is. And it's quite fun to present them with this puzzling phenomenon of seahorse mating, where what you can see here is that there's this individual on the right inserting something, the anatomical name doesn't really matter here, into the brood pouch of the other individual, and gametes flow from here to there, they get fertilized here, and then later little seahorses come out. And of course, this is a famous creature because it's the male that becomes pregnant, as it's cutely explained in any possible aquarium situation where the public is educated about these things. But usually the public education doesn't go to explain why do we actually call this individual a male. And you might think that, especially if you're a sort of naive biology undergrad, that it might have something to do with the sex chromosomes that people have found. But actually, it turns out that people have looked for sex chromosomes in these creatures, but they haven't found any. And that's not terribly surprising, given that there's actually a lot of things where sex determination works without sex chromosomes. You know, think about the turtles, where the temperature of the egg determines whether you develop as a male or a female, or the sex-changing organisms, and so on. But why do we actually call this guy on the left a male? It's simply really a definitional thing. So in order to know unambiguously what we are talking about in each case, there is a definition out there that the male is simply the sex that produces the smaller of the gametes. So the sperm-producing individual is the male, and usually the size dimorphism is immense, so you can see that the sperm are tiny, tiny, tiny compared to the eggs. But there are, of course, situations, for example, in some algae where the gametes are actually of very similar sizes. And then we don't talk about males and females, we talk about plus and minus mating types and so on. So this is just to put the definition in place. But it's interesting to think about the consequences of everything that follows from this definition. And one of the most profound ones is the so-called twofold cost of sex, which sometimes, and actually quite often in the literature, is misinterpreted to have something to do with, you know, you just halve your genetic representation in each of the offspring when you have sex because there's genes coming from somebody else as well. But it's really the evolution of males rather than the evolution of sex per se that causes this cost. And just to go through this argument why this is the case, I'll show you a few schematic pictures here. So here's a population that reproduces asexually. So this pink stuff here is all the resources that one individual can gather from the environment to produce, in this case, 5 eggs. So here's one asexual female, here's another one. So the population as a whole is producing 10 young, each parent has 5, and because this is asexual reproduction, you have 100% parent-offspring relatedness. So each parent gets kind of 5 copies of its genes into the next generation. We can also have sex, but in the algal style, so that we don't have males and females. And here you could, at first sight, it seems that it's the sort of gamete dilution that's responsible for the cost of sex, because for each young that you're producing, you have some meiosis going on, and therefore you get only half of your genes into there, half comes from some other individual. But if you realize that this other individual is also doing exactly the same thing as you're doing, gathering the resources, putting them into gamete formation, then, okay, there could be some costs that relate to sort of having to find mates and moving to achieve that, and, you know, there could be diseases that get transmitted and so on, but there's not really a twofold cost. So if these other costs are not applying, then you get, again, a total of 10 offspring in this situation. Now each parent gets 10, and that actually counteracts the gamete dilution cost, so that as a whole, you will actually get equally many gene copies into the next generation, despite having sex. But there is actually a twofold cost that comes about when we start having these males that, again, they gather a lot of resources. But think about something like an elephant seal that uses all these resources not to take care of the well-being of the young or of the female that is trying to feed these young, but just to fighting off other males. So these males are then using or squandering, you could say, all these resources into zero-sum games over paternity against other males. And the poor female has to alone provide all the energy for the next generation. So now, whether you think of it as the total of the population level productivity, or in terms of gene copies, 5 times 50% is certainly smaller than 10 times 50 or 5 times 100%. So now we have a twofold cost there. So it seems to be a relatively silly way to organize reproduction to have these males, which is why evolution biologists are actually the people on this planet who have the least well understood idea of why sex exists in the first place. Everybody else seems to know what it's for. But of course, I was making a very drastic assumption here, which is that the males really are using all the resources just to outcompete other males. They have otherwise no particular effect, either positive or negative, on female reproduction. And of course, this is sort of a null hypothesis, which is not always true. There are certainly males out there that do take care of their young. And I have spent quite a lot of my career trying to understand why it is that sometimes males do so much and sometimes so little, kind of transferring of the material goods to the next generation. But before I go into the reasons of why this might be the case, here's some evidence that it really does seem to matter when it comes to estimating population growth and things like that. And this is a study that wasn't actually collected or published for this reason at all. It doesn't mention the cost of sex and those kind of things, but I'm using it to make some interpretations regarding the topics that I'm interested in. So what these people did was to look at the correlates of productivity in various bird populations, and they had data on 980 bird species, which is a lot. This is about 10% of all the bird species that occur on this planet. And they were dividing it according to all kinds of, ecological correlates and so on. But one of them was whether parental care, which always happens in birds, is provided by the female only, or by both parents, or maybe in some cooperative settings and so on. And they found out that the female-only care was the only one that deviated from all the other ways to organize reproduction. And if you had that, so that the male does nothing, then you actually got a 20% productivity reduction in the population, comparatively speaking. Did you have a question? Yeah. Well, this is 980 bird species, so it's... oh, right, okay. Every other way than this one here, the way they lumped it is that I think if there was more than two individuals of any sex, then it was categorized as something else than this one here. But I should actually check that because the paper is not completely downloaded in my head, but I think it was that way. So you can actually conclude from this that if the males do something, that it actually reduces the cost of sex. And a back of the envelope calculation shows quite clearly that you get a 1.6-fold of cost of sex from it rather than the full twofold. And I actually put this slide in this morning because I kind of cannot resist talking about it, even though for reasons of time, I thought I'd leave it out from this particular talk, because it kind of like is a, even though this example is just within one species, it shows quite nicely that male behavior does seem to matter for population dynamics. So this is something that I did together with collaborators in Australia who have studied this wonderfully polymorphic finch for a number of years now. So as you can see, it's very clear that the head color can be either black or red. Sometimes they are just dull, but they are juveniles. So both females and males, when they are adults, they have this color pattern. And these colors seem to correlate really well with distinct male behaviors, that if you have a black head, then you are a very good father. You take a lot of care of the young, you breed really well, really successfully, but only if you can maintain a nest site, which are these sort of cavities, very nice because they're protected from snakes and things like that if you're in a difficult to reach place. But these are always in limited supply, and they fight a lot over the ownership of these. And the reds are the winning type when it comes to these fights. And you end up with an interesting frequency-dependent selection there, because the reds, they initially have an advantage if all they have to outcompete are the blacks, because they tend to sort of go like, okay, you know, you take it. But if they then, if the reds increase in frequency, they more and more start fighting other reds, and then it sort of looks like they're spending so much of their energy and time fighting that they essentially forget to feed the young. So their breeding success plummets if there's a lot of other reds in the population. And because this seems to be mainly a male behavior, so again, we have been able to show that if you have a lot of reds in the population, then for the same habitat, you actually get much less individuals being able to live in a certain area. So it really seems to have population consequences as well. So as a whole, I've been just trying to convince you here that this sort of very classic population dynamic assumptions that, you know, female reproduction is the important thing, and whatever the males do there, they are just sort of little sperm supplies and we don't have to take account of them separately, that doesn't really hold in a lot of systems. It matters how they behave. But the big questions that have been intriguing me in recent years is, well, why do we have this incredible variation in how they behave? And a sort of much more fundamental question that I'll try to say something about at the very end is that, why do we even have this silly sperm producers around in the first place? I hope that didn't get recorded. Probably did. Right. So when do males care? So if we first have a look at the empirical patterns out there, just across all the taxa of animals, if you think about your average mammal, I already mentioned elephant seals here. So they are actually quite typical in the sense that about 90% of mammalian species have female-only care. So that male interest in the, you know, whatever happens in reproduction, it really stops at fertilization. And thereafter, they just go on to find the next female. In birds, it's almost the reverse. So that in about 90% of the species, care is biparental. So both parents do something for the young. Sometimes there can be more than one. More than two individuals feeding at the nest. But if you look at it quantitatively, then it turns out that the female often does more. For example, it could be that she is the only one incubating, but then at the feeding stage both contribute, or she feeds a little bit more, and these kind of things. Amphibians, that's a bit of a more egalitarian story, but not usually in the way that both parents take care of the young. Sometimes there's no parental care at all, by the way. But it's more in the sense that the number of species or evolution transitions to male-only care is about the same as the corresponding number to female-only care. So it seems to be that there's not a huge bias either way. In reptiles, there is a bias, again, so that female care is much more common. And then there's the big exception, which are fishes. And I put a seahorse here. Again, this is a pregnant pygmy seahorse male. But you don't have to be a seahorse to be a caring male in fish. It's actually about 9 times more common that if you have parental care in a fish species at all, that is provided by the male than by the female. And then, just to be complete here, invertebrates, massive group, their care is actually relatively rare, but when it exists, it's much more often by the female. So as a whole, I could say that care is disproportionately a female business, except if you're a fish. So remember that the definition of a male was really something to do with something that's a bit trivial sounding. It's just about the relative gamete sizes. And a lot of my work has revolved around the question of whether it's really just the gamete size that explains all the other things about sexual dimorphism that gets created. And I guess the very short answer to this is that, well, no, it doesn't seem to explain everything. And I'll just quite quickly, without going into the maths, unfortunately, because I want to cram in a lot of ideas into this talk, t- tell what we think that the math shows about the logic of these kind of things. So if I had been stopping to work on this topic in 2008, I would have said pretty much the following, that we are more likely to end up with these male care situations when, firstly, these are quite logical outcomes, so I don't really have to show the maths here, I hope. Paternity is high. That means that if a male or if a female is mating with a lot of males per brood, then for each particular male, it's quite uncertain whether he is going to be the actual father of this young. And that reduces the average sort of genetic payoff that he gets from each unit of care given. So therefore, a priori, all else being equal, high paternity situations lead to high male care. Also, mating success should not be strongly repeatable for male care to be stable. And the logic here is that if it is strongly repeatable, this is about sexual selection, then you are, for example, an elephant seal male that is much larger than the other males. You are the one who gets the ladies. And if you have mated with one, then she's unlikely to be your last one. So it would be a bit silly, payoff-wise, to stay with this one female and take care of that family, because then you're foregoing all the opportunities to beat all the other males in access to the females in the future. Whereas if mating success is not strongly repeatable, then the other guys have such a good chance that their presence is actually a serious hurdle when it comes you to succeeding again, given that you have succeeded once. So you might as well take the biggest payoffs out of the current mating attempt and stay with the female and her kids. And finally, this sounds really simple, but it has been overlooked quite a lot in the literature until recently, that often there are mortality differences between males and females, partly based on what they do. So for example, if females, for whatever reason, have a higher mortality than males, then there are simply not very many females around, and because you are not interested in mating with the dead ones, you are more likely to stay with one female and take care of the young if the adult sex ratio is very male biased. And there's been some fun empirical studies trying to look at these correlates. Once you publish a prediction, then that in a very nice way makes people look out for those patterns. For example, in shorebirds, where there's huge variation in whether male or female or both together take care of the young, and showing that wherever you have data available on the adult sex ratios, it seems to be supporting these views quite well. But I also said that it's a bit of a 2008 statement that I was taking here, that these three factors should more or less explain what's going on there. And lately, a very smart student of mine pointed out that, well, if you think about this incredible prevalence of fish male carers, it's probably not true that paternity is always highest, or paternity certainty is always highest in fish compared to all these other creatures. You know, they live in the water and there's a lot of sneakers and sperm is sort of flowing from other males to the eggs. This risk of sperm competition could actually select for the males to stay nearby and defend the eggs against anybody else who wants to fertilize them. And this, I'll come back to that later, could form a first step towards male care. But that is actually a more general principle, that whenever there's some external reason to stay close to your young, that could be predisposing a population to develop more care for that particular sex. And I'll just go back underwater to the invertebrate case to show an example of how this taxonomic diversity can give you new ideas that are no longer actually totally related to parental care, but are actually something more fundamental about how reproduction is organized in situations that are quite different from the sort of mammalian cases that we normally think about. But it's about the same principle, that it's really hard to care for young if this very basic assumption doesn't hold, that they should be somewhere near you so that you can do nutrient transfer or you can defend them from predators or something like that. And they will definitely not be anywhere near you if you're something like a coral and you spawn out into the sea and then you get these larval stages that float around to go somewhere far away. And in these marine invertebrates, the first step to providing any extended parental care is called brooding, which means that the female part keeps the eggs in or on the female body instead of throwing it out into the ocean and hoping for the best. And so I'm trying to understand why in this case it seems to be the female role to do this holding onto your gametes and not the male role. Again, remembering that it's really just about a size difference when it comes to the ultimate difference between males and females. So I got a PhD student working on this topic. Here he's in the Australian desert thinking about marine invertebrates. And then we both realized that we actually know very little, either of us, about this kind of like huge collection of taxa. So we got Dustin Marshall on the project as well, who actually, unlike either of us, he actually knows what these things are called. And to me, they look like some sort of blobs. But they, when you start digging into this literature that was very new to me at the time, you realize that there's an amazing amount of data and patterns that are just crying out for explanations. So for example, stony corals alone, which are only a very small subset of all the diversity that exists underwater, they have this astonishing number of transitions between, on one side, you can see this brooding that I mentioned. We also call it sperm casting because it, unlike broadcast spawning, it's not that both sexes send their gametes into the ocean. It's only the male side that does so. So sperm are out in the ocean and they're looking, in the brooding case, for eggs to be fertilized on or in the females. And in broadcast spawning, that basically means that both sexes do the same thing and just hope for the best. And there seems to be some correlations between that and whether you have separate sexes, so that in some corals, for example, the male corals are separate from the female corals, or then you can also have hermaphrodites, where one individual can produce both eggs and sperm. So, how does this work? Here's just to give you an idea of the biology, what goes on in there. Broadcast spawning, I guess you all kind of like understand what happens there. You have these things, they have some capability of kind of sniffing out each other and moving in the right direction and so on. But as you can imagine, there's a lot of waste, a lot of gametes just not finding each other at all and being unlucky. So that's clearly a problem. But you also have problems of reproductive success in the sperm casting case. So here, basically, the dynamics goes like this. So that the females are, they're not totally just passively waiting for the sperm to swim by, but they have often some sort of pumping mechanisms and they try to filter sperm from the seawater. And of course, like I said, these can occur in hermaphroditic organisms too. So here the combination of the pink and the blue is that you can produce both sperm and eggs. So here's one combination where you have hermaphrodites and they are also sperm casters. But there are also species that are hermaphroditic and broadcasters. So the question is there some logic as to when an organism should go for each of these options? So just to recap the number of possibilities that we have here, there's the broadcast spawning where both sperm and eggs are released. There's the sperm casting where the sperm are released and the eggs are retained. There's, hypothetically, you could imagine that there would be egg casting where the eggs are released and the sperm stay where the male is, but this is only used by unicorns. As in, there hasn't been a case found in nature of an egg casting species. And then finally, if both sperm and eggs are retained, then you can't actually reproduce unless you mate, which I use that word to mean that the adults actually physically come into contact of each other, which probably means that there should be some mobility. So for most marine invertebrates, this is actually not necessarily an option. There are some barnacles that have just really long penises with which they can do this, but that's also mating. So I'm not actually talking about this as an option here because the whole pre-adaptation to achieve that has to be there in place, but I'm more interested in comparing these three options. And biologists have for quite a while wondered if this comparison might be significant. And here's just one example. So here's a sperm caster, a tiny little cute thing, weighs about 5 grams. Here's a broadcast spawner, which is a monster, weighs about 0.5 kilo when you know, on average. And this kind of correlation with body size seems to be quite repeatable across taxa. And people have had several ideas about why this might be the case. But there's also other patterns that are quite well known empirically, but so far without much modeling effort until this clever student of mine started working on it. So I already mentioned that the broadcasters, they are often big, comparatively speaking. Sperm casters tend to be small. The sperm casters, they are themselves small, but relatively speaking, they have large offspring and large eggs. They also tend to be hermaphroditic more often than the broadcasters are. And then finally, I already mentioned that the egg casters don't exist. Explaining non-existence of certain biological entities is also an interesting thing for a theoretician to try to understand. And I said already that we have a lot of data on all kind of allometries, that the body size, which kind of features here quite a bit, has to do with the fecundity, which is the number of eggs per time unit that you can produce. Larger things also tend to occur at lower population densities. It also has to do with flow. So if you're an organism that pumps water actively, you're basically a bigger pump if you're a larger organism. So the key idea in this model is that we look at something that you might not think about when you study female reproductive success in something like vertebrates, which is that you might have to worry about the availability of sperm. Normally, sexual selection people think that males have these terrible problems because there's so much sperm in the world and there's so few eggs, and therefore you have to compete with all the sperm from other males to fertilize the eggs. But in the marine world, where you have a huge ocean around you, you might have similar trouble with your eggs as well. So if sperm is not endlessly flowing around you because you are not mating, you are living in the ocean, then let's say that you have this many eggs and you only, as this creature here, you manage to capture 2 sperm, then here you get 1/4 of your eggs fertilized. If you have a smaller amount of eggs to begin with, then you might have a higher fertilization success per egg. And that turns out to be important for a lot of things. So if your fecundity is low to begin with, then this problem of eggs competing with each other for sperm is a little bit lower. And when are you a creature that has low fecundity in the first place? Well, if you're small, then for the same egg size, you have less energy to produce them, so you are constrained to have fewer eggs. So you experience this problem less severely to begin with. And that actually already, again, I'm not showing the equations because in this particular case, they actually turned out to be quite ugly with all these co-evolving traits. But the model conclusions are quite robust, that we end up with the idea that body size via this fecundity relationship predicts that if you're big, then you should really broadcast, which means send your eggs outside into the ocean as well, because then you're reducing the competition that your eggs experience by being very clumped very close together. Whereas if you're small, then you go for the sperm casting option. And this pattern, by the way, it has been found pretty much wherever it has been looked, so it seems to be quite a repeatable thing in the ocean. But then we also have this second thing, why should the sperm casters have larger offspring? And here, again, if you take the same principle, but now let's compare the sperm caster with the broadcaster, and I hope I've convinced you that the competition for a sperm that's floating past here is more intense when you're clumped together like this than here, where this egg is already in a different region in the ocean. So this can lead to a potential solution if you stay within this type of breeding, which is that, well, you're not going to get all your eggs fertilized anyway, so you might as well invest more in fewer eggs. They will get the sperm, more of them will get fertilized, and you have essentially less waste. And often it's very good for the offspring to start out being large in the ocean, because then you have already outgrown some of your predators, and you have more energy to begin with. So this trade-off gets shifted to a different balance when you have sperm limitation, like you will have in the sperm cluster. So that seems to be the second pattern there. Then we also have the third pattern, which is that sperm clusters are also much more often hermaphroditic. So why might this come about? And again, this is the same picture. You are unhappy here because you have all these eggs and they are not going to get fertilized, so you have wasted a lot of your reproductive effort. And then, of course, one way how you can get fewer of them and yet get some compensation for by having some alternative route to fitness is that you actually start allocating into male function as well. Not all of your eggs are going to be fertilized anyway, so you might as well go for the male option and become a hermaphrodite trying to fertilize somebody else's eggs. And finally, we have sort of explained all the three patterns here, but then we also have the problem that we don't ever seem to find the egg clusters out there in the oceans. And that actually falls out of the equations very easily because if we are keeping one type of gamete in the body, then if anything, it should be the eggs rather than the sperm for the following reason, that if the parameters fall in a manner where this is already too much competition, so the eggs should not stay this close together, then surely so is this one here. The sperm are smaller, so a priori for the same energy, you can always produce more of them, and they are not going to succeed if these ones don't. So if you release one of the gamete types, or if you better release the eggs, then you should definitely always release the sperm as well. But it's kind of like when it comes to empirically predicting the patterns that we see out here, it's quite intriguing because we are saying that sperm limitation in the sea could be responsible for a lot of the interspecific patterns that we see, but we don't necessarily say that an empiricist should find strong evidence for sperm limitation at present. It sometimes is actually found, but it's very hard to make predictions about when it should happen, and the reason is following. So basically I'm making the point here that we might see the smoke from the reason that is underlying a lot of the evolutionary transitions there, but what is left is just the transitions themselves and not the underlying problem that this adaptation was about to solve. And the reason is the following, that these are actually predictions from the model. If we arrange things according to body size, we predict that the proportion of eggs that are fertilized, it will be low if you are a small broadcast spawner because it's hard to fill the ocean with your gametes then. And it will also be low if you're a large sperm caster because then your eggs are, you produce so many eggs and they are clumped together and they can't do anything about the fact that the pumping efficiency doesn't increase fast enough with the body size of the animal. So therefore, you should actually predict that these guys here, they will switch to being sperm casters. These guys here will switch to being broadcast spawners. So you end up with a pattern of body size correlating with what you do, but you don't actually end up with very low fertilization success rates here because those solutions no longer exist. So that makes the whole story a little bit challenging. But what I find it to somebody who is a bit naive to the underwater world like I am, it's really quite interesting that when you have this huge problem, this dip in fitness, that I would imagine that it would be easier to evolve just to be a little bit smaller and not go here instead of changing your whole reproduction that you suddenly kind of release the eggs rather than keep them and so on. But if you look at the transitions that happen in the phylogenies, they seem to be quite flexible about how the whole thing is organized. So that's just sort of nice. So back to mating, which is an option once you're mobile or once you have long penises and things like that. The similar principles that might have this sort of predisposed females to be in the caring role might happen there as well. So if you think about something a bit more familiar to us, such as a horse, if you have internal fertilization that happens inside the female, then of course the mother of the foal is bound to be present when birth happens, whereas the same is not necessarily true for the father. He might be around or he might be not. So the options are, it's a very simple reason to get a bit of a phylogenetic constraint in there, that whoever is present at a certain point in time is can start being selected to stay around for a little bit longer as well. But that, of course, it per se doesn't say that it has to be the female who does the internal fertilization business, because, you know, like in the seahorses, it's the male that has taken this role. But in general, the point is that whenever you have phylogenetic inertia, that you just kind of like keep caring a bit more because you already took the first role, first step in that direction, that's the kind of true but boring explanation for patterns. It gets interesting once we start getting these phylogenetic transitions that in one taxa something happens and then you get a deviating pattern in some other taxa and then try to figure out why the differences are there. And that's why I'd like to return to the bird example. We don't know much about the dinosaurian cases, but birds, we do have these quite strong differences in how much the males are contributing to parental care. So here's, for example, the sage grouse that where the male does nothing for the well-being of the young. They are interested in this very sort of mammalian type mating system. And it's quite encouraging for our theories that these systems, they also tend to associate with having male-biased adult sex ratios. So that there's just, female-biased adult sex ratios. So that there's basically a lot of females to mate with, and therefore there's not strong selection to stay with one of them. And I already mentioned that this was just a sort of statement I made about the sage grouse, but it seems to hold generally when people have started to investigate it. But it's one of those cases where getting good data on things like adult sex ratios is actually harder than you think. So maybe that's one of the reasons why this thing, for example, has been less well studied than, for example, the paternity thing. But I'd like to return to the fish case a little bit. I was talking about the proximity to young being selected for in these broadcast spawning things, and fish are another example where whether the things get fertilized outside or inside the body seems to matter. And this is the student in question who actually pointed this out at a journal club. It was just sort of an idea that came to our heads by reading something different. And he pointed out that, as I said, it's not necessarily the highest paternity that leads to the strongest predisposition that males will start caring, but it could be paternity concerns, so that if you don't do anything about it, you end up with low paternity, but there is something that you can do about it, and that means staying with the young to protect them from outside influence. So just to explain what he means by this, imagine that you are a fish where fertilization is external. So this is the model assumption. And the female has laid the eggs, or the eggs are now outside the female's body, and you are there to spread your sperm around it. But there can also be these sneaker males around. And it always takes a little bit of time before you can be sure that, you know, all the eggs really are fertilized. There can be all kinds of slime that the sperm have to swim through and so on. And now if the female has laid her eggs, she doesn't really have huge concerns about whether they are really hers. They will always be. The male cannot be sure about paternity, but he can improve his paternity chances by staying around and chasing off all other males from the vicinity for a while. And that means that there's a certain selection to do this for longer, which means that if you start from very small guarding durations, then the sex that generally has been staying for longer, according to these principles that I was telling about, is selected to increase their guarding durations up to the point over there on the wall where only one sex stays. I'm not showing the entire zoom out here. But you can see that there's this tiny asymmetry here in the model, that males have this extra reason to stay around initially that the females don't have, and that's the paternity protection. And because of that, from initial no-care situations, you have this area where you stay around for a little bit and you get into much, much, much longer caring durations just because you were the one who was in the position of staying with the young in the first place. But external fertilization is actually interesting for another reason, which is that all these models of caring in general have assumed that while you're caring, I was talking about these elephant seals that hypothetically would stay with one female. I've been making the model assumption that that means that you cannot get new fertilizations while you're taking care of the baby. A sensible assumption for a lot of the models and for a lot of the taxa, but for fish, it's actually not true. Because very often caring in fish takes sort of this biological setting where there's a brood of eggs. The male doesn't feed each egg separately. It's not like in birds where, you know, once the young hatch, they have to be fed individually, which makes it costlier the larger the brood. Instead, what he's doing is to generally keep the area safe, chase predators away, and so on. That means that if a new female comes in, she might be actually more interested in somebody who already has somebody else's eggs in the nest, because that kind of only increases the commitment of the male to the current brood. And I should also mention that because the males cannot really feed elsewhere, because it's a full-time job to take care of the safety of the nest, they might sometimes eat some of their own young just to keep going. And if that happens, then, of course, from a female's perspective, there's no reason to have any sort of sexual jealousy. If anything, you should prefer a male who has other females young as well, because then if he eats some, it's less likely that they're yours. So the whole trade-off is flipped to its head in fish. A caring male is a sexy male, not a sort of male who's prevented from mating again. And that means that we actually predict what has been found in data. So these are evolutionary transitions from one fish species to another, that if you start out in a phylogeny from external fertilization and no parental care, you much, much more often get to male-only care than to female-only care. Whereas if you have internal fertilization within the female in this case, then based on this sort of phylogenetic boring inertia reasons, I think, you end up much more often in female-only care in fishes. So if I have still a little bit of time, do I? Yeah. Why do we have these males in the first place? That's sort of an interesting question. Why do we end up with this huge difference between sperm and egg sizes? And again, it's kind of interesting to go back into the environment where all these things evolved, which is the ocean. And also go back into the literature quite a bit, because people often, so the phenomenon I'm talking about is anisogamy, unequal gamete sizes. And people often think that it was Jeff Parker who first pointed out that there's a problem to be explained. That's not strictly true, especially if you read German. You find these papers published in the 1930s already, which is an interesting mathematical model. And it's also interesting because it was written during a time when people had no idea that evolution doesn't optimize what is basically good for the whole species and so on. So it sort of uses this wrong optimization criterion, but gets into very interesting mathematics as a result. So that was followed by a much more modern paper written in the 1960s, which basically expanded the results here by taking gamete depletion into account. So here's a little bit of an explanation of what goes on in here. In this 1930s paper, there's principles of statistical mechanics on particle collisions to determine how these little particles, if there's many or few of them, different sizes, how many sexual unions you manage to achieve in the population as a whole. And this one here, it's basically the same model, but added gamete mortality, so the fact that you might die before you ever bump into somebody, and you also get depletion, which means that if you have bumped into somebody, then you're no longer available for new fertilizations. So the field really got its proper trigger in the 1970s, which was the era when people realized that evolution doesn't actually necessarily optimize what sort of the best reproductive rate in the entire population, So Parker et al. Wrote this incredibly famous paper showing that you can actually understand this whole thing from an individual selection perspective, where let's start with an isogamous population. This means that everybody produces the same gamete size. But let's say that there's a little bit of variation. This is always what evolution is based on. And here, I've just exaggerated it so that some of them are really small, some of them are really big. And then his model is based on the idea that if you specialize in producing slightly smaller than average gametes, then you can produce more of them. It's basically a basic economic principle here. Whereas if you produce big ones, then the advantage is that no matter who you fuse with, you have a well-provisioned start of life when the zygote is formed. So both types seem to have an advantage. And of course, you know, then there's certain selective pressure for the small ones to try to go together with the big ones, because otherwise if they start mating with each other, they're very numerous, so they can do this a lot, but the results don't survive particularly well. And the ones in the middle are sort of jack of all trades equals master of none kind of things. They don't survive particularly well when they're zygotes, and they are also not particularly numerous when they're produced. And assuming suitable trade-offs between these fitness components, you can actually show that there's disruptive selection, that you end up with a small and a large type. And the small ones essentially parasitize the reproductive effort that the big ones put in there. So the way it's in the textbooks is that we end up with this kind of like parasitic gamete type that specializes in searching for the resource-providing type, which are the eggs. So what we wanted to do here, and here the we, this is again a former student of mine, was to realize that maybe something got thrown out with the bathwater when these earlier works were dismissed as being group selectionist, because there was sort of the wrong optimization criterion in there. But otherwise, it's actually, there's some really nice math in there, because all this depletion and all the dynamics of what happens in the sea, there's actually, it's kind of fun to think about how that would combine with the general ideas about the disruptive selection at the individual level. So, and then while we were doing this, we also realized that we can also comment on a bit of a storm in a teacup that's going on in the anisogamy field at the moment, because people seem to be a little bit uneasy about whether this whole thing is a sign of conflict or cooperation. And these one and two, these are not conflict and cooperation, but they are actually, this is all about conflict. This other alternative here is about cooperation. And I apologize, there's so much text so late in the afternoon on this slide. But I'll just walk through it at a reasonable pace. So the first one, the first idea, which is sort of the Parker worldview, is that there's this primordial sexual conflict being played out at the initial stages of gamete evolution. So that if there are a bit more, I don't call them males yet, I just say that there's blue and red gametes. If there's a little bit more of the blue gametes, because they start to be a little bit smaller than the others, then they obviously have a harder time becoming a zygote than the other ones, because there's just more and there's competition and so on. And therefore, it doesn't make sense for evolution to favor provisioning these gametes really well, make them big and full of nutrients and so on. Instead, you should try to make them small and numerous so that you can outcompete these others who are also producing the blue ones. And that leads to this disruptive selection like I was showing in the blue slide before. But this alternative way of thinking about it is much more cooperative, which is that it's sort of a division of labor. If you're in the ocean and it's hard to find each other, then if the blue ones specialize in producing the searchers and the red ones specialize in producing the nutrition, you know, the nutrient or energy containing ones, then this is to everybody's benefit. So evolution is a sort of coordination game that makes the sizes best suited to this task of finding each other and yet ensuring the survival of everybody. And sometimes you find papers where there's almost like an emotional dislike of one of these ideas that, you know, why is such an ugly term parasitism needed to describe this beautiful relationship between males and females. So we didn't actually set out to distinguish between these two alternatives, but it turns out that the model actually interestingly comments on that. So here's finally what the model does. And I know I'm running out of time, so I'll try to make this happen fairly quickly. So we have a certain budget per time unit for the gamete production. We divide that into certain sized packets, which is the gamete size, and therefore per time unit we can produce a certain number of them. And here we see that the blue side is already, for whatever stochastic initial reason, it's producing slightly smaller, slightly more numerous ones. And then when these things meet, this is my proudest PowerPoint moment, the size, so this is the sort of volume of the zygote, is the sum of these two things. Today, of course, the sperm are so tiny compared to the eggs that, you know, totally doesn't matter what they contain, but initially it doesn't have to have been so. And then for the survival, we have some kind of a function that your survival is really poor per time unit if you are too small. We also need the survival of the gametes until the time point of fusion, but this time point is not fixed because it depends on the densities of the different availability of the different types in there. So what we do is to look at the equilibrium situation. So we have the X and Y, the blue and red here, and what happens here is that we have the different numbers of the adults. Let's say that there's, for example, in this case, for any local body of water, we have two of the red ones and we have two of the blue ones. We can put, of course, whatever values we like there. And here's the production, so the rate at which you can afford to produce the different gametes depends on their size. Then we have the mortality of the gametes while they are still free-floating before they have become zygotes. And there, we use this function that sort of introduces more or less a minimum size below which you just cannot survive at all. And thereafter, your mortality doesn't ever go exactly to zero, which is intentional. And then finally, we have the fusion. So this is just fairly straightforward. And the total rate of offspring production by each of the mating types is this. So here we have the rate at which you meet each other, and it depends on the densities that you manage to produce this stuff out there. And of course, it is a game, because it doesn't depend only on what you do as a red type, but also of what the blue types do, because that determines what is the availability of the opposite sex gametes ready to form fertilized units. And I just jump straight to the outcomes of this, because that's kind of interesting. So if the parameter which specifies the adult densities in the ocean is low, we find that evolution always produces an isogamous solution, just one stable equilibrium, where the blue and the red don't actually diverge to be different at all. We can change that by increasing the number of adults that are in sort of contact via their gametes with each other. And it's quite interesting what you get out of this. So here, if on average we have something like four individuals in the local pool of water, we have three possible endpoints of evolution. So we can be here, where the blue ones have become very big and the red ones are small. So here we would say that the blue type has become the female, the red type has become the male, or the opposite, depending on where you start. And if you have started from somewhere near the isogamous line, then you actually end up maintaining your isogamy. If you increase the number of interacting adults more, then you find that the basin of attraction to this isogamous equilibrium becomes narrower and narrower, and eventually it becomes unstable, and you basically always end up with the tiniest deviations from the isogamous sizes lead to anisogamy, where either the blue or the red becomes the male. So this is kind of like the conflict scenario, and it is conflict because the females have kind of lost to the other individuals, which now are males, help in producing material resources to the offspring. They would be better off if the males behaved in a different way from before. But there's also, these are not the only parameters in the model, and there's actually three other parameters that all have the equivalent mathematical effect there of increasing the difficulty in one way or another of gametes meeting each other. So for example, the easiest one is gamete mortality per time unit. If you just survive less well per minute in the spent in the ocean. I should actually mention a biological fact is that these gametes, after release on their own, it's a matter of minutes. If you haven't fused with somebody, you're dead. So in reality, it's quite harsh out there. And that actually leads to, so here I've just sort of put kind of like the distance between these two types is different. It has a similar effect on the outcomes here, that you end up with the isogamous solution being unstable and you end up with an isogamy, either the blue or the red ones becoming the males. So here's the cooperative solution. And it's kind of interesting that both come out of the same model as opposed to us saying that, you know, for whatever reasons we believe that one or the other have had to be the underlying reason of it. So the slightly tongue-in-cheek take-home message that I'll end this talk with, so you can finally go for drinks and so on, is that whether this whole male-female complicated business ultimately reflects conflict or cooperation seems to depend on something like population densities of ancient marine invertebrates, which is kind of something that we don't know very much about. So that's, I think that's kind of nice to end the talk with. I should also mention that if you are interested in joining my lab to answer these kind of questions, I've got a slightly funny funding situation at the moment, which means that I can promise a very short postdoc with possibilities of extending it, but the extension money isn't there yet, but it's likely to be there. So it's a bit complicated. But talk to me if you're interested.